everyone, and welcome back to Barnstable this morning. I'm Sarah Colvin, and joining me live in the studio, Town Manager Tom Lynch. Tom, good morning.
Good morning, Sarah. Did you get all your shopping done?
No. I still have to do some, so it's busy. How about you? A little bit.
I was actually in the mall, but I did a little shopping, but I was also there for the Hanukkah celebration that they're in their 20th year of doing that from the Shabbat Center, and the rabbi has invited town officials each time, and where Jessica Rep Grossetti, the council president, and I went. We both brought greetings from the town. I've been, enough times now that while we all have our traditions that we might do of family traditions, or maybe it's a village stroll, or, you know, caroling, or taking a ride in the car to see all the lights that are out there, I've come to get familiar with some of the traditions of Hanukkah, which, certainly include, the lighting that goes on, but there's also the giving of gelt, where, there's money given, and that's to try to teach the idea of giving back and charitable donations, things of that nature. There's the yummy food that goes on, and they had that there again, fried food. There's the dreidel, the games that are played, and of course the miracle that they celebrate of the oil that was used to light the lamps to cleanse the holy temple after the oppressors had been, driven back. So it's interesting to, be in a setting like that where, you see different traditions than your own, and it's all part of the, and that's a festive celebration for members of the Jewish faith, and they certainly, celebrated last night. So it was a very nice ceremony, and they hold it at the mall, so it's kind of, a lot of activity around.
I'm sure.
There was some dancing. It was very good.
That's wonderful. Now, do they keep the large menorah? Do they keep that up there throughout the duration of the holiday?
Yes, and actually they. They light, I think they're in the sixth night yesterday, so they lit the six candles and actually had the candles burning. But during the week, they have lighted candles that are in there to signify where they are in the celebration.
Great. So really nice.
And I told the crowd that I thought the rabbi could have a second job as a booking agent, because he always has an unusual act that's there. And they had, last night it was Colin the Quilt, and he wore a kilt, and juggled and brought the kids up and did things on a unicycle.
Interesting.
The year before it was someone who actually shot ping pong balls out of his mouth in a juggling routine, and then also, would hit things, like an apple or something, and put it in a cup from 20 yards or something. So there's always, some entertainment.
Unusual entertainment.
And people seem to like it. So.
Well, that's wonderful, and I'm glad that the menorah will be there, so people who are in the mall doing that last-minute shopping will be able to look at it and think about that tradition as well. So we got some news, Tom, over the weekend about our superintendent of schools. Now, we had heard last week that she was a finalist, and I've heard that she did indeed get that
job. Late Friday afternoon, the Lexington School Committee met. They selected her unanimously, and she began making calls around. And I think, as you've already reported, the school committee is now going to meet to see what their next steps will be. She may have some more information in terms of things that may be happening, but in the next interview. She's here through the school year. We'll be working very closely together on the school budget. And also on the capital budget, so we have that work to do. That's not going to stop, and there'll be continuity, in the system through the end of the year, and then we'll see with the school committee who they have leading it after that.
So. Exactly. Well, we'll certainly, Mary Chakowski is our next guest, so we will talk with her a little bit more about that. Now, in your e-news, there was a great picture of Ann Splin and a member of the Community Impact Unit signing a grant application that really could do some great things for the CIU.
Well, we have talked about the Community Impact Unit that's down on Main Street. They operate out of the Hyannis Station, and they've been, working all through the summer, and they've gotten to know the homeless population, other needs that are on the street of individuals that they may encounter on a daily basis. Officer Jen Ellis, who works, in the team, came in because she is applying through the Department of Mental Health for an innovative jail diversion program grant. And there are really three components to that. The first is that they're trying to get individuals into services. So rather than get them in a situation where there's a crime been committed and they need to be incarcerated, divert them before that happens into needed services. There are two other parts of the grant that are important, though, and one is there's some intervention, crisis intervention team training. So they'd have six officers that would be trained in how to diffuse a situation where someone is perhaps resisting arrest or is going to be in a situation where they could get arrested for their behaviors, try to calm that situation down based on the behaviors that they're being confronted with. And then the third is that they're asking for funding for three officers to go for mental health first aid training. So it's again a way of being able to deal with individuals in their setting and also divert them away from a crisis that would put them into the jail. So when we had a meeting with them, Mark Ells, the assistant town manager, just said, in what ways could we support you? How could, what obstacles are you finding? And after having been on the street now for, several months, they are finding that they need greater assistance with, the mental health issue. So the core of the grant that I should have mentioned right at the beginning is that the funding would be used to bring an actual clinician, a private clinician, into the patrol car or into the street patrols that go on. So that individual will be right there to assist them and divert, again, I use the word divert, into some other social setting that would be appropriate for them in terms of getting the proper services.
Absolutely, and so very important, because many times they really need that yeah. mental health help. That's something that perhaps a police officer might not be trained to do, but the clinician will be trained to do.
Well, and I think one thing Officer Ellis mentioned time and again was the collaboration that they've had and the support that they've gotten from, whether it's the court or the DA's office or the Duffy Center or any of our social service agencies, in particular Department of Mental Health. And that's the sort of collaboration you need to try to tackle a problem. I think they've been very thorough with it. This is a next step to say, listen, we need this funding. And it would be a two-year grant, and we're really hopeful that, I was pleased to be able to support it, and we're really hopeful that they'll get it.
Absolutely. I love this next story and this next thing that happened in terms of some young kids who are trying to get together to solve something that they perceive as a problem.
We get a lot of requests. People use email, they write letters and come in and see us and talk about issues that they have in their villages. It's one way we find out about the things that are going on, so we naturally encourage that communication back and forth. Councils are great about bringing issues to us in terms of fixing things. So I was surprised to get in the mail several letters from Mrs. Sproul's first grade reading group over at the Barnstable Community Horace Mann Public Charter School. And they had just read a book called Help the Forest. And they took the time to then make pictures of what the woods behind their school looks like now and what they'd like to see it look like. And they all had, dear town of Barnstable, we have a problem and we need your help. And they went on to talk about the woods that were behind there and ways that we might be able to tackle the problem. So I did what I would do in most instances. I contacted the Department of Public Works, asked them to go over and take a look so we could get an idea of the extent of the problem. I put together an initial letter that I sent back to the class, just letting them know that I appreciated their activism, that we needed activism at all levels, and that they had done the appropriate thing in terms of speaking out and reaching out to the town, that We would do an investigation of it, and then we'd get back to them to let them know what would happen. So Dan Santos, our Director of Public Works, is in the process of looking back there. You know, it raises a bigger problem, and that is that where you may have at one point in time organized a volunteer community effort to go back and in and try to deal with, you know, trash and whatever that was there. With all of the opiate issues and things of that nature, we have to be very careful about who you send in, what sort of training they've had, what sort of safety precautions you have. You're bound to find needles and things of that nature. We don't want that may or may not be back there in
right.
the woods, but you know, we find it in just about every setting, and we're very careful with our own DPW workers to be sure that they're conscious of that. So we'll be responding to them, and I hope that you know, when we've settled it and we get it back, that we their hope that they see for the sunshine and the
yes.
and the clear pond that's back there and the butterflies and it all looks beautiful, that we'll that's what we have. On this one, you can see the sun has a frown. Here, the sun has a happy face.
So we want to make sure the sun has a happy face, right, Tom?
It brightened my day, and it was a problem I think we can solve, and we'll certainly be working with them after the holidays. So.
Absolutely. Well, that's great, and I think good to show the kids that, you know, that they can make a difference in their town is a really wonderful thing. So we're, you know, this is our last live interview of the year, Tom. We're
yes.
getting into the year in review mode. I know here on Barnstable This Morning, we're going to have our year in review on TV, and there's going to be some news and e-news in terms of year in review as well.
Well, you know, we've had a very successful year, you know, financially. We've kept you know, the budget in check, and we've been able to meet all of our financial obligations. All our enterprise accounts have finished in the black. I think as I look back on this year, it's a, you know, 375th celebration, that while we had serious business, we also were able to weave in a whole lot of events that were just great, and I applaud Council President for her leadership on the 375th committee, all the work that the committee did, and all of the villagers for the way they participated. So you'll, when people go on and see our little video and read about our year in review, I think they'll see several events from the 375 celebration.
Absolutely. Well, Tom, I thank you so much, as always, for joining us here on Barnstable This Morning.
It's always a pleasure.
Thank you. Likewise. And we'll see you a little bit after the first of the year in 2015.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Mary Tchaikovsky is next here on Barnstable.